Praise the Lord this evening. I greet you in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This evening it gives us great joy to come to you once again to present to you, our study on the book of Daniel. With me on the set is Reverend Dr. Sharman Alexis, and we have been working together on this project, on this study, and I know that for the past 6 weeks, you have been thoroughly blessed. This evening, we look forward to another great blessing as we do a study on chapter 7, which has to do with, the opening of the second part of the book of Daniel, which is the prophetic aspect of the book. We said last week, chapters 1 to 6 cover the historical aspect. There were some elements of the prophetic within these chapters as well. And we did highlight some of these, in our studies. And chapters 7 to 12, they are strictly prophetic. So we thank you this evening for being on the set with us to do this study. And God bless you. And we just want to open in a word of prayer. Father, we thank you this evening for this wonderful privilege to be able to share your word with your people, God. We thank you, Lord, for your presence here with us, and we pray this evening your anointing will rest upon our eyes, and Lord, you will reveal to us the deep truths that are enshrined within your word. Lord, thank you for Reverend Dr. Sharman Alexis, Lord, for Lord making herself available to be an instrument in your hands, to be used by you, O God, as she unfolds these deep prophetic, Lord, truths to your people. Lord, we thank you also too for Brother David this evening for his spirit of excellence and his commitment, O God, to this assignment. We bless everyone on the set this evening, all our viewers, all our listeners. We bless you this evening and we commit this time to you in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Spend Amen. A pleasant good evening once again, and it is a joy for us to continue our study in the book of Daniel. Today we treat with chapter 7, as Pastor just indicated, how the book is divided historically and prophetically. What we will observe too as we come to chapter 7, it is not particularly in a chronological order, as the first six chapters would have been, because you would realize that when we closed in chapter 6, we closed with Belshazzar's feast, and the Medes and the Persian came in, and Babylon fell. However, as we start this evening, we will see we are at a different point. What I do want to bring out is that this entire chapter covers some visions that Daniel had, actually, three in number. The first vision that he had was the vision of the four beasts, and that will be covered from verse 1 all the way to verse 8. And then from verse 9 to verse 11, we have another vision, a second vision, which will give to us the judgment scene. And then the final vision is covered in 13 to 14, where he speaks about Jesus Christ actually receiving the kingdom. And so we will be doing those three visions. As we come to verse 15, to the end, we will realize that what Daniel does here at the beginning of 15, you will recognize that he is in deep concentration. He wants to know a little more. And so he speaks, you know, to the watcher there, and the watcher unfolds. So some things you will see in the first section, but you will see it in a clearer sense as we come to the area of the explanation. So let's begin this evening, and we will begin with from verse 1 to verse 8. And we're looking at Daniel's remarkable dream. It says, in the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon, Daniel had a dream and visions of his head upon his bed. Then he wrote the dream and told the sum of the matters. So the first thing we will see is that this dream, or these visions that were given to Daniel, was in the first year of Belshazzar. When he received these visions, he wrote it. And that is in keeping with Old Testament principle, where when God will give to them a prophet, a prophecy, they would write it. We will see that in Isaiah chapter 8, verse 16, Isaiah 30, verse 8, Habakkuk 2, and verse 2. We will also see it in the book of Revelation. And I'll just read one verse. Isaiah 8, 1 says, moreover, the Lord said unto me, take thee a great scroll and write in it with a man's pen concerning Mahashalahashbat. So God gave the instructions to write. So even as Daniel got these visions, he immediately wrote it. However, he is now delivering it here to us in chapter 7. And so it is in the first year of Belshazzar's reign that he gets this dream. But if you look at it, it says a dream, and then it also says visions. So we need to understand the difference between a dream and a vision. A dream, of course, is when you're sleeping. You will get dreams during your sleep. A vision, however, unfolds a little more graphic. Because what a vision does, you may go into a sleep, have a dream, come out of the dream, and then you would see as though, you know, the whole ceiling opens up to you. God just opens up heaven to you, and you have a clear vision of what God is showing you. And it seems, as we look at this reading, that this is what happened to Daniel. He went to bed that night. He started to dream. And probably the startling dream that he was having, he came out, and then he begins to see all of these dreams unfolding before him in the form of a vision. And so verse 2 says, Daniel spake and said, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of the heavens strove upon the great sea. And as we look at the four winds, I want to draw your attention to, let's look at Ezekiel chapter 37. And we are going to read verse 9 in Ezekiel 37. Verse 9. Then said he unto me, the Lord here speaking to Ezekiel. Then said he unto me, prophesy unto the wind. Prophesy, son of man, and say to the wind, thus saith the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live. So as we read on, we will see Daniel spake and said, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of heaven strove upon the great sea. So the four winds, as we would see in scripture, represents the very Spirit of God breathing all across the land. So when we think of the four winds, you think of east, west, north, south. So it's the Spirit of God breathing over this great sea. Now this great sea, based on what his knowledge, it would have been the Mediterranean Sea. But as we continue, we will see where many times in prophetic scripture, when it speaks about sea, we'll also see it in the book of Revelation when we get there, that the sea represents the peoples of the earth. So here the Spirit of God is moving. But how is it moving? It's moving upon the great sea. And so there is a tumult, as we will say. You know, there is confusion. There is something that's going on that's creating that kind of a stir upon the earth. And the Bible tells us that as he sees that in his vision, where the breath of God is breathing, the Spirit of God has begun to move in a new and in a different way, and everything, that sea just seems to be chaotic. The world is in a mess, and there is no question as to we are heading in that direction. And then it says here, as he looks upon the sea, as he looks upon all of these peoples of the earth in tumult, what does he see? Verse 3, the four great beasts came up from the sea, diverse one from another. So he saw four great beasts, each of which was different one from the other. And so he continues writing the first beast. So we are going to look at this dream and his vision and actually what he saw. And so he sees, first of all, let's read verse 4. The first was like a lion, and it had eagle's wings. I beheld till the wings thereof were plucked, and it was lifted up from the earth, and made stand upon the feet as a man, and a man's heart was given to it. And I trust that you're seeing the image that we're trying to portray there for you. So the first beast he sees, it's like a lion. So when you think of a lion, you think of strength, you think of power. But that lion, he had what? He had eagle's wings, which gives us a slightly different picture than you would of a lion. When you think of a lion operates and walks and moves with a certain kind of stealth. However, an eagle flies, and it flies rapidly, flies swiftly. So we are seeing the look of the lion, but we are also seeing the speed or the swiftness of the eagle in the wings. I beheld till the wings were plucked. So with that speed that it was coming, and it was probably growing and developing, there was a plucking, yes. There was an end, there was a cutting, yes, short of that lion, and he lifted up from the earth, and he made to stand upon the feet as a man, and a man's heart was given to him. So immediately here we see that picture of the lion. If we go back in history, as we did in chapters 1 to 6, we knew very well what kingdom we are talking about, but it's going to come up a little bit later as we interpret. And so that kingdom, we know it to be the Babylonian kingdom. The head of that kingdom, we know him to be Nebuchadnezzar. We also know that he was a man, and God had to work on this man. And it says here, a man's heart. So though the imagery is that of a lion, a man's heart is given to this great lion. And he goes on to say, behold, another beast, a second. And this beast is like a bear, and it raised up itself on one side and it had 3 ribs in the mouth of it, between the teeth of it. And they said thus unto it, arise and devour much flesh. So when we look at it here, immediately again, your mind's supposed to be thinking based on what we've covered so far. So what you see here, you're moving from that Babylonian empire, headed by Nebuchadnezzar. And remember, the Babylonian empire was crushed by the Medes and the Persians. Hence the reason you see this bear being lifted up on one side being stronger than the other. But this bear, he had some devouring. He did some crushing. He has 3 ribs in his mouth. And so the scripture tells us, arise and devour much flesh. And after this, I beheld, and lo, another. So we come now to the third beast. Another like a leopard, which had upon the back of it 4 wings of a fowl. And the beast had also 4 heads, and dominion was given to it. So again, we are seeing creatures, not whole in themselves, but that kind of a mixture in their presentation. So as we look at the leopard, we realize here that the leopard has upon its back fowl wings, the wings of a fowl. So a leopard doesn't carry wings, but this leopard is carrying the wings of a fowl. And this particular beast had 4 heads. So we know one time off the bat from the Medo-Persian Empire, we had the Grecian Empire. And we know that under the Grecian Empire, that empire at a certain point in time was divided into 4 parts. Yes. And each of which would be represented here by each head. Yes. Again, as we look at this, you would realize that Nebuchadnezzar, he had a vision of an image. And he had, in that vision of the image, he saw the empires. God gives to Daniel now the vision, the same picture, but he is giving it to Daniel from a totally different perspective. So as we look at the historical kingdoms in the past, we would realize as we begin to do the interpretation that in the future, there's a different look to these kingdoms. And it says here, verse 7, I saw in the night visions, and behold, a 4th beast, dreadful and terrible and strong exceedingly. It had great iron teeth. So let's just break this verse up here. First, as he sees this beast, it is the 4th, it is dreadful. He cannot fully describe this beast. It is terrible. It is strong. And it is not just strong, but it is exceeding strong. And it had great iron teeth. So immediately there we know that we have now moved from the Medo-Persian Empire to the Roman Empire.
Yes.
The Roman Empire that was depicted in the image by the iron legs. It devoured, it broke in pieces, and it stamped the residue with the feet of it. Now remember that Roman Empire had 2 legs, but that Roman Empire had feet.
Yes.
But when you come down to the feet, you had the mixing of the iron and the clay. And so clearly we are seeing that at this point, not at the beginning of that of the Roman Empire, but coming down to the end of the Roman Empire, we see that crushing. It says here, and it stamped the residue with the feet of it, and it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it. One of the things that made it diverse, it had 10 horns. So we are seeing here the Roman Empire stamping the residue at the end of its reign. And we see 10 horns coming out of it. Look at verse 8. I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn. So he looks at this terrible beast. He sees the 10 horns. And as he looks a little closer, somewhere
where those 10 horns were in operation. Yes. As he looks, you see right in there, a little horn is coming up. And as we do the interpretation, we will see what that little horn or who that little horn is. So he came up, another little horn, before whom there were three of the first horns plucked up by the roots. So here we had 10 horns, but as this little horn comes up, that little horn comes up with power, at a certain point, that little horn is going to crush three horns. So as we do the interpretation, the representation of the 10 will now be swallowed up. This little horn is going to swallow up three and bring a certain measure of subjection, yes, to the others. And behold, in the horn were eyes like the eyes of a man. Mm. So again, we are moving from just that picture of a beast to the picture of a man. He had eyes like a man, but he had words that were speaking great things. Mm-hmm. Pastor, take it from there for us, from verse 9.
Amen. That was excellent expository teaching and preaching and great exegesis, Reverend Alexis. From verse 9, I will just read to verse 12, and then I will try to give a measure of understanding before we go further. So verse 9 reads, I beheld till the thrones were cast down, and the Ancient of Days did sit, whose garment was white as snow, and the hair of his head like the pure wool. His throne was like a fiery flame, and his wheels as burning fire. A fiery stream issued and came forth from before him. Thousands ministered unto him, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. The judgment was set, and the books were open. I beheld then because of the voice of the great words which your horn speak, I beheld even till the beast was slain and his body destroyed and given to the burning flame. As concerning the rest of the beasts, they had their dominion taken away, yet their lives were prolonged for a season and time. Now, these verses from 9 to 12, they give us some insight into the future. And then in verse 12, it takes us back into the past, the historical past of these same four kingdoms. Now, in the Bible, there are many judgments that you would see mentioned. And this is a judgment that is being prepared and established. Jesus is about to execute a judgment. Now, for those of us who know Bibles well, we will know that in 2 Corinthians 5, there's a judgment called the Bema judgment, which is the judgment seat of Christ for those of us who will go with the Lord, you know, when the rapture takes place. That's where we are judged for our works. Then in Revelation 20, there's a great white throne judgment where all the wicked dead will be judged from Adam's fallen race right down. That's the final judgment, the white throne judgment. And we see that in Revelation 20. However, this judgment is not the Bema judgment for Christians. This judgment is not the great white throne judgment. This judgment is called the judgment of the living nations. And we see here a picture of Jesus coming. And this, we need to just give a little insight as to what is happening. The rapture has already taken place. Daniel has not been given that imagery with respect to the rapture of the church. The church has been raptured based on these verses. We are in heaven, but something happens. After the rapture of the church, we have the coming of the man of sin, the little horn, the Antichrist. And he actually would be there for the last 7 years, known as the times of Jacob's trouble. For the first 3.5 years, he would appear to be a very peaceful, a very welcoming person. And the whole world will go after this man. In the last 3.5 years, we would see when the mark of the beast is released, that the Antichrist would change his whole strategy, not only towards the Jewish nation, but towards, you know, people. Everybody would have to, just like in Daniel chapter 3, they would have to take the mark of the beast with the number 666. And if you fail to take the mark of the beast, that will be the, you're facing the possibility of a martyrdom. And what is going to happen here at the end of the 7 years of tribulation, Jesus Christ comes again. When he comes at the end of the 7 years of tribulation, there's going to be a battle called the Battle of Armageddon that will take place in the Valley of Jehoshaphat. We see that in the book of Joel. At the end of that Battle of Armageddon, Jesus is going to establish his millennial kingdom. So between that Battle of Armageddon at the end of the 7 year period and the millennial kingdom, millions of people would still be on the earth. This is the earth that was, you know, facing tribulation for 7 years. There will be saved Gentiles, saved Jews. You also need to know too that many people who would have taken the mark of the beast, and I want to submit, you know, that the mark of the beast, as much as the number 666 is, the Antichrist is so skillful, they're going to be able to have some kind of technology where people will have that mark implanted in them in some way. So when Jesus comes at the end of the 7 years, there will be millions of people still alive. There will be Jews who would have actually refused to take the mark of the beast. There would have been Gentiles who would have refused to take the mark of the beast. And there will be many people who would have taken the mark of the beast still alive. So what Jesus is going to do, as he states in these verses, this is going to be the judgment of all the living nations. So he's going to be judging every nation one by one. And as they stand before him, remember, he's the all-seeing, all-knowing God. So he knows everything. So someone who may have the mark of the beast in a very inconspicuous place, whether on a forehead or a hand, the Lord will know that. So what he's saying here is that in this judgment, those who actually refuse to take the mark of the beast, they are considered, you'll see that in Matthew chapter 25, verses 31 to 46. He called them the sheep nations and the goat nation, or the sheep from the goat. Those who are sheep would be those who would have actually maintained their integrity. They would have actually, in different ways, they would have tried to even help others who were going through times of suffering. Because remember, during the tribulation, there'll be extreme suffering. There'll be many people who are non-Jews who will try to help Jewish people who are being persecuted by the Antichrist. So God, Jesus Christ, spoke in these verses in Matthew. He spoke about those who help the least of my brethren, who give them a cup of water, who give them a shelter, a hiding place. He says he will not lose your reward. So the people who stood faithful to Jesus and those who help others in the times of suffering, when the Antichrist was on a rampage, devouring and martyring and killing people, those will be blessed, and they will go, their reward will be that they will go into the tribulation. But those who actually would have taken the mark of the beast and actually thought that they would have gotten away, you know, they will face judgment. And this is what is happening here. This is the judgment of the nations. And Jesus will be doing it in a very strategic way, nation after nation. He'll come to Trinidad, then he'll go to Tobago. All the nations, he'll be dealing with them, and everyone will have to stand before him. Every nation will be judged so that no one will escape. That's the very first serious judgment. As we said before, when the church is raptured, we face the judgment seat of Christ, where we are judged, not for sins, but for the works, what we did while we were on this earth. So as Jesus is presented in this passage, let's look at verse 9. It says here, you know, thrones are set up or established. And that takes us to Revelation chapter 4, where we see the 24 elders. They are placed on thrones. Amen. As we sit with Jesus in the heavenlies. And then it says here something very beautiful. It says here, Jesus is portrayed as the Ancient of Days. When Reverend Alexis returns to read from 13 right down to verse 15, you would see that the Ancient of Days comes up again. And sometimes people get confused. But what you need to understand is that John chapter 10, verse 30, we need to know that Jesus made a statement. He says, I and the Father, we are one. So Ancient of Days is used as a picture here of Jesus in Daniel chapter 7, verse 9. When we come down to verse 13, the Ancient of Days here is God the Father, and he gives the kingdom to his son Jesus. So the names are interchanged beautifully because of the oneness of the Godhead, because Father and Son, John chapter 10, verse 8, Jesus says, I am the Father, we are one. So sometimes people get confused and they want to know who really is who. In verse 9, it's a picture of Jesus. We see him here dressed in white, his hair white as snow. So he's in a white gown. You know, his hair is white as wool. It says his eyes like a flame of fire, his hair like wool. And this is the imagery we would see when we study the book of Revelation chapter 1. When John saw Jesus, the eyes, flame of fire, that speaks of judgment. Hair of wool speaks of his wisdom and his years of experience in dealing with judicial issues. So he is the perfect judge, so to speak. Even in legal circles, you know, judges wear the same type of finish, you know. They have these little wigs because they're supposed to sit and adjudicate in matters with respect to, you know, law. So Jesus Christ comes here as the perfect judge. It says here also too, his throne was like a fiery flame. That speaks of the glory of God. You see that in Isaiah chapter 6. When Isaiah said the Lord, he says, you know, the smoke and the train and the glory of God filled the temple of God. So his throne is a glorious throne. And he also says here, he says his wheels as burning fire. We will see that in the book of Ezekiel. Wheels represent activity. Wheels represents movement. And we are seeing God here actively moving and working in the affairs of men. God is never stagnant. God is never static. God is never, you know, laid back and slumbering and sleeping. Everything that is happening, God's prophetic calendar is constantly in motion, bringing things to pass, because God has a determined destiny. He has a prophetic calendar that must work according to his timing. So the wheels here, that is showing us that God is actively at work in the affairs of mankind. And then he comes again in 10 and he speaks again about the fiery stream. It is a glorious stream. And he says, thousands of thousands minister unto him. That speaks of what? Jesus being ministered by an innumerable company of angels. These are angelic beings. And we need to know all through the Bible, you'll see the word thousand or thousands of thousands. Because in biblical history, there was no concept of millions and trillions. So thousands of thousands really means in the original language a number is infinity. So God is not giving us like a specific number of angels. He's just telling us thousands of thousands, which is a number that you cannot conceptualize, you cannot even count. So these angels are ministering to Jesus around his throne. And then for the nations of the world now that he's come to judge, look at the next. He said, and 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. In other words, they are standing awaiting his judicial intervention. So the nations of the world are there, and they are waiting for Jesus Christ to execute judgment upon them. And then he says here, what I love here, he said here, and I beheld because of the voice of the great words which he on speak. I beheld till the beast was slain and his body destroyed and gave him to the burning flame. And this takes us back now at the end of the tribulation. What is going to happen is the Antichrist, who is also called the beast, and the false prophet. We see that in Revelation chapter 19. They will be taken and placed into the lake of fire. They will be the first one to be dealt with in this judgment. So the judgment of the nations will be taking place, but the Antichrist, who did all the destruction and all the evil, as well as his partner called the false prophet, both of them would be placed, not annihilated, they'll be placed in the lake of fire. They'll be the first to enter the lake of fire. And the Bible also tells us here that verse 12, as concerning the rest of the beasts, they had their dominion taken away, yet their lives were prolonged for a season and a time. That takes us back now, historically, from the Babylonian Empire. What God's word is saying here, that Babylon, Medes and Persians, and the Grecian Empire, all these empires, even though they were evil empires, Gentile nations, their dominions were taken away, and eventually they evolved into the next empire. And the Roman Empire, which is the empire Jesus Christ comes in, because God establishes four empires here, and the fifth empire will be his millennial kingdom. So you're saying here, all the previous empires before the Roman empires, they went out of power, you know, in a way that, you know, they still in some way, they existed in the following empire. You see, but this empire here, the Roman Empire, when God comes at this time to judge them, their power, this is what he said here, it was actually the dominion, you know, it was taken away. It was demolished. You know what I mean? It's like never to rise again. So if you look at the Roman Empire or all the previous empires, you'll see Babylonianism evolve into the Medo-Persian Empire. You'll see the Grecian Empire evolve and came into the Roman Empire. And today what we need to know about Romanism is that the Roman Empire was established under the Caesars. And after some time, the empire divided into two. But we did that before. The Eastern Empire, the headquarters was Constantinople. And then we see the Western Empire, the capital was Rome. And as we moved on, eventually the Roman Empire, somehow it subsided. But in a very subtle way, the Roman Empire is still in existence. And then coming to the end of time, we're going to see a revival of the old Roman Empire. And with that revival, what will also happen is that there will be still a fragmentation of that Roman Empire. That's why we saw 10 toes down to the bottom of the image. Those 10 toes, even though we're thinking in terms of 10 kings or 10 kingdoms, there'll be a fragmentation. What the Antichrist will do is very strategic. He will use his influence. We see him here portrayed as the little horn coming out of the 10 toes. He will use his influence to control 3 of those 10 toes, so to speak, or those 10 kings. And with that, he'll be able to establish his power and eventually rule the whole world. But as we saw before, his rulership will only last for a 7-year period. So God bless you, Reverend. You can give him here.
Praise the Lord. So we look at let's just look at 13 and 14. We don't have much time left, and we do want to go into the explanation of the dream. I saw in the night vision, and behold, one like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven and came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him near before him. So this is very, very clear to us. He saw in his night visions the Son of Man. Now this title, Son of Man, you will not see it in the Old Testament other than in connection with Ezekiel as a prophet with respect to Son of Man as a prophet. Outside of that, we do not see this particular title in the Old Testament. What we would see, however, in the New Testament, that Jesus himself referred to his own self as the Son of Man. And so that Son of Man, who is Jesus, he will come with the clouds of heaven. And who does he come to? As we shared earlier,
He is the Ancient of Days. But as we come to this segment, we see where he comes to the Ancient of Days. So the Ancient of Days here, representative of God the Father. And they brought him near before him. So Jesus comes before God the Father as the Ancient of Days. And there was given him dominion and glory and a kingdom that all people, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed. So again, much of that was explained. Jesus comes in and God gives to him a kingdom. And in that kingdom, it was a kingdom of glory, not just an empire, but a kingdom that is going to overtake, as we would say, all men, all mankind. It says here, all people, all nations, all languages. You know, when we speak about every knee shall bow, every tongue confess, every language, every people will do what? They will serve him. And that kingdom, that millennial kingdom, it goes on to say that it is an everlasting dominion. So the power, the authority, once more, Jesus reclaims every bit of authority that the enemy may have had a little bit of leeway. There is no power, no authority. As Pastor shared, you know, the false prophet, the Antichrist, they are cast into the lake of fire. And Jesus now stands with all power, all authority, all dominion. And this kingdom will never pass away, and this kingdom will never be destroyed. So let's look at the last segment here, as the dream is explained, some of which you would have shared already, and some you would be able to explain.
Thank you, Reverend Alexis. So from verse 15, it says here, this is Daniel testifying. It says, I, Daniel, was grieved in my spirit in the midst of my body, and the visions of my head troubled me. I came near unto one of them. He's speaking of one of the angelic beings now, because he's in this vision, and he's saying, and he asked him the truth of all this. So he told me and made me know the interpretation of the things. These great beasts, which are four kings, which shall arise out of the earth. And it says here, but the saints of the Most High shall take the kingdom and possess the kingdom forever and ever and ever and ever. It's amazing. Between 17 and 18, the actual 7-year tribulation period, that 7-year period has already come and gone. So we move from tribulation into the millennial kingdom, where the saints have now possessed the inheritance. And they are reigning and ruling with Jesus Christ, you know, as King of Kings, Lord of Lords. And then verse 19, you know, he wants to know a little bit more. He wants to go deeper. So in verse 19, he says, then I would know the truth of the four beasts. So he understood now that it is like the battle is over. You know, it's like everything has already been won. You know, and it's like, he's seeing here now. He said, but I would know the truth of the four beasts, which is the Roman Empire, which is the four beasts. He says here, which was diverse from all the other exceedingly dreadful, whose teeth were of iron and his nails of brass, which devoured and break pieces and stamped the residue with his feet. That residue there speaks of all the previous, everything from the previous kingdoms and nations. They are dismantling everything, every system, everything, because they want to establish their own rule and their own laws. And of the 10 horns that were in his head, and of the other which came up, that other is the little horn, and before whom 3 fell, that would be 3 of the 10 kings or kingdoms the Antichrist would overrule and bring them under his power. He says, even of that horn that had eyes, which speaks of intelligence, and a mouth, which speak great things. In Hebrew language, that great things, it's not an uplifting thing, but blasphemous things. So this is the Antichrist who will be speaking blasphemy against God. And when we come to the book of Revelation, God's Fair Life, we will see all these things develop more deeply in Revelation chapter 13. It says here, he says, whose look was more stout than his fellows. And that speaks of his pride and his arrogance, you know, that you know, in which he ruled, speaking of the Antichrist. He says, I beheld, and the same horn made war with the saints. So that horn is the little horn that we spoke about that came out from the 10 who devoured 3 of the kings. And it says here, he made war with the saints and prevailed against them. That statement is implying that during tribulation, as much as God will be dealing with the Jews, but there are many Gentiles who will refuse to take the mark of the beast, as well as Jewish people. And all of them together, Jews and Gentiles, collectively, those who refuse to take the mark of the beast and embrace Jesus, the word of God calls them saints. So the Antichrist, because of the fact these people refuse to take his mark, just like the three Hebrew boys, you know, he will actually seek in every possible way to annihilate them. And the Bible says he will even prevail. And over so millions will lose their lives by virtue of refusal to accept the mark of the beast. But at the same time, Jesus will intervene, as we see in the book of Matthew, so that he doesn't wipe out the whole, you know, the whole generation. He says, I beheld, and the same made war with the saints and prevailed against them. Until, so he was prevailing until, in this context now, we're speaking about Jesus once again. So we see Ancient of Days alluding to Jesus, Ancient of Days alluding to God the Father later on, and back here again now, we see here Jesus being portrayed as the Ancient of Days. He came and judgment was given him to the saints of the Most High. And the time came that the saints possessed the kingdom. The same thing we saw earlier on in verse 18. To possess the kingdom also means to inherit the kingdom. So they are inheriting and becoming a part of the millennial kingdom with Jesus Christ. And it says here in verse 23, then he said, the fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom upon this earth, which shall be diverse from all kingdoms, and shall devour the whole earth, and shall tread it down, and break it in pieces. And the 10 horns out of this kingdom are 10 kings that shall arise, and another shall rise after him, and he shall be diverse from the first, and he shall subdue 3 kings, and he shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear the sayings of the Most High, and think to change times and laws. That's very instructive. You'll see that all through Daniel. So one of the characteristics of the Antichrist, he will change times and laws. He will change laws with respect to marriage laws. He will change laws with respect to things that the headship of the man in the home. We see a move already taking place, especially with respect to the violence against women. There are many groups and other NGOs, they're striving for certain rights of women. Nothing is wrong with that. But respect to the fact that, you know, they are challenging in the headship of the man. So the Antichrist, when he comes, he'll be ensuring a lot of these things happen, where the authority structure in the home, you know, will be diminished, you know, and within the church and different things. But I shouldn't say church, because the church will be raptured. But he will come to the place where, more or less, like all people say today, you know, there are many rivers that lead to the same sea. So he will establish, you know, help to establish a universal world religious system, so that in changing laws, like how we say, there's only one way to salvation through Jesus. He will change laws that will change that belief, so that everybody would believe that their religious system could take them to God. And at the end of the day, those people may end up losing their very souls if they don't come to know Jesus. So he will change times. He will change laws. And he said, and it shall be given into his hand until a time, times, and dividing of time. And that is a prophetic statement that involves 3.5 years. So the Antichrist will be given 3.5 years. The first 3.5 years of the 7 years, he will be a very quiet, you know, inconspicuous person, plotting all his strategies behind the scenes. And everybody will believe that he's the most perfect, ideal person. Because remember, he has to come as a counterfeit of Christ. So he has to play his game well. But after 3.5 years, we'll see in Revelation 13, he will establish this image in the temple in Jerusalem and call the entire world to worship him. And as a result, for those 3.5 years, something will happen. Verse 26, but the judgment shall sit, and they shall take away his dominion. And that speaks again of Jesus coming in suddenly at the end of the 7-year period to deal with this Antichrist system, to consume and to destroy it unto the end. And the kingdom and dominion and the greatness of the kingdom under the whole heaven shall be given to the people of the saints of the Most High. This is another way of saying that Jesus will come and establish his kingdom, where he will reign and rule as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And it says here, whose kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions shall serve and obey him. And then at the ending, Reverend Alexis, you want to hear this last verse and wrap up? Praise the Lord.
Hitherto is the end of the matter. As for me, Daniel, my cogitations much troubled me, and my countenance changed in me, but I kept the matter in my heart.
Yes.
And you know, when you think of the revelation that God gave to Daniel through the angel,
yes,
there was just so much for him to swallow at that point in time. You know, it's like everything was happening at the same time. And Daniel says, as I came to the end, I couldn't even contain myself. And so, you know, even as we think of the end of time, you know, we want to continue to challenge you. We are at a very crucial point in time. Any moment, the rapture can take place. And Jesus, after 7 years, will return. There is a real kingdom that is going to be established upon this earth for a 1,000-year period, that millennial kingdom. And the saints of God, inclusive of those who went before and those who are going to come through tribulation, we shall inherit that kingdom.
Yes.
Father, we thank you.
Yes.
We bless you and we praise you. King of Kings,
yes,
and Lord of Lords. We honor you as the Most High God. And Father, in Jesus' name, we pray, oh God, that we will be able to sense the urgency of the hour upon us, Lord. We pray that people will come in to the ark of safety and be saved. We pray, oh God, that Christians, oh Lord, will get serious about living a holy and a godly life in these days. And oh God, we will preach this gospel. We will proclaim it with everything that we have. And we thank you again this evening. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
God bless you.
We love you. Until next time, in Jesus' name.
Amen.